Amen. Churchianity versus Christianity. Churchianity versus Christianity. In the church, there are two kinds of people, okay? You have Churchians and you have Christians. And Pastor Paul, you just made that up. Yeah, not just, but I did make it up, okay? It's a word that I've coined, Churchian. But one thing you have to understand, and because I made it, I can pour meaning into it. A Churchian is anything but a Christian, a Christian. And what I understand to be a Churchian is what Malachi is preaching against at this point. There's going to be hundreds of years of silence before God after Malachi. But Malachi, as he proclaims, he's got this burden on his heart, and he's proclaiming and he's saying, God deserves better worship than you are offering. Look at the worship that you are offering to God. Worship, give that kind of offering to somebody else in power, somebody else of prestige. Give it to your governor and see if he'll take it. And he won't. That's the point. So the worship of Churchianity is a non-worship. It's a shallow worship. And let me describe some of the ways that Malachi describes this, what I'm calling Churchianity today. In Churchianity, the people are making offerings to God that are not pleasing to God. They are making vows to God. I'll give a certain percentage of my income, but they're not going to do it. They do it for pretense. They do it so they look good. So they do it because they want to be a part of the system of the church, but they're not doing it before God, and they're certainly not keeping their vows. The Bible speaks about tithes and offerings, and they're not offering that to God. And some people say, well, the tithe is not appropriate for the new covenant time. Well, there are places in the New Testament too that speak of tithing, but it seems to me that we who live on this side of what Jesus has done ought to offer more, not less. And whatever percentage we offer back to God does not only represent a certain portion of our lives, but our entire lives. Whether that's $1 or thousands of dollars, it's your whole life that you are offering in worship. How is that going to be represented? Also, Churchianity here, it speaks of people who do God lip service. They come to God, and not only lip service, listen, they do God tears service. They come to church and they weep tears. Some of us think because we came to church one day and we got all emotional and we wept tears, that faith has to be real. It's got to be authentic, right? But there are people here, the Bible says, you cry at my altar. And I can't accept that kind of worship. You always say, why can't you accept that worship? Because while you are crying here at my temple, your wife is crying in a corner somewhere in her home because you have divorced her. In other words, you come here and you pour out your heart with your needs before me and you're crying in front of me, but in your private life, there is no true adoration of me. There is no true love to me. There is no reflection of your loving me in your life at all. Because a clear reflection of your love to me should be your love to your wife or your love to your husband. And that is a mess. So Churchianity is a two-faced religion where you look all good and you look even weepy at church. But your private life, it's a mess. It's not honoring to God at all. It's two-faced. It's hypocritical. And that's Churchianity here. Let me describe Churchianity a little bit further. Churchianity is a religion where you are caught up with the religion itself, but you are not caught up with the Christ that it points to. You're caught up with the comfort that it provides. You're caught up with the culture that you get to imbibe, but you are not caught up. It's not for the sake of Christ that you're supposed to be worshiping. That's a problem. That's Churchianity. In our day and age, I think you can divide up Churchianity into a couple of categories. And I see it like this. There are those people for whom church or Jesus is just something they do. It's something they add on. It forms a small part of their identity. Say that very important word with me, identity. Say it, identity. And for them, Christianity is a part of their identity. They grew up in that atmosphere. And you know, a huge majority of Americans say that they are Christian, right? But the vast majority of them do not attend church regularly. They come to church, what, maybe 3 times a year? Thanksgiving, Easter, and Christmas, right? Yeah, pretty much. Well, that's what I would call churchianity. That's what some people would call comfort Christianity, but that is not true Christianity. Christ exists, church exists for you, then that's not worship. Who are you really worshiping? What are you truly worshiping if the church exists for your comfort? If God exists for your comfort? If God is made in your image, who is God at the end of the day? It's not the God of the universe. It's you, right? And that, I would say, is churchianity. There's another form of churchianity. This form of churchianity, this form of churchian, comes to church every week. And for all intents and purposes, he's a very, very exemplary Christian. Goes through all of the motions, maybe a deacon, maybe an elder, maybe even a pastor in the church, right? But religiosity is still all about him. It's all about her. It's all about prestige. It's all about what you look like in front of everybody else. What people will say about you. Good Americans go to church, and that's why you go to church. That's a churchian. Do you see what I'm saying? Especially in an immigrant society, in the Korean society is that way. I don't know how it is in the other societies, but a larger percentage of people, Koreans in America, go to church than in Korea, right? And a lot of that has to do with being a part of the culture, being a part of the system, as it were. That's religiosity, but that's not relationship. Do you see what I'm saying? There is a clear difference between the two. You can get religion whatever you want, but relationship is a whole different story. Having a relationship with God is entirely different than having a religion about God, right? And so a lot of people are in church consistently so that they can get some good morals for their families, so that their children might get some morality as they grow up and be upstanding citizens of society. They want to go to church regularly so that they too can kind of step into the fabric of stability. But again, that is churchianity if that is all that is. There's nothing wrong with morals. There's nothing wrong with stability if that is pointing to the true Christ of Christianity. But if Christ is absent from that, that is churchianity. That is not Christianity at all. And it is my great fear, one of my greatest fears, that at the end of the day that we might have a whole bunch of churchians, that the house might be a breeding ground for churchians and not Christians. Do you understand? That we might make it comfortable for people to get church without getting Christ. And I hope we become a place where churchians come, because I love churchians. I do. I love churchians. I love people who are interested about Christ or who have some concern, are impressed about Christianity, and they are at least dipping and dabbling. I love that, but I don't want them to stay there. I want them to come all the way across and not be settled with being a churchian, but become a true Christian. Do you understand what I'm saying? Because God desires that kind of worship, and God deserves that kind of worship and nothing less. The worship of a Christian. The worship of a person who truly worships from the soul. Because look, is God really interested in your pocketbook? Does he really want a little bit more of your money? Is your time so important to him? Oh, please, please, please give me more of their time. Is that the kind of God that you serve? That's not the point. You missed the point altogether. What's the reason, God says, that you need to offer me heartfelt, bottom, core worship? It's because of who he is. Understand? It says here, I will be praised from the rising of the sun to the setting of the same. My name will be extolled in all of the nations because it's that great of a name. Why are these people in Malachi's time missing it? Why are they being settled for church? Why are they settling for churchianity instead of Christianity? Because they are not seeing God for who he is, for how great he is. If they knew that if they remembered that they were dealing with the creator and sustainer of the universe, and this is what you're coming to God with all your offerings, with your life and things, then wouldn't you rather feel always like you can't give enough rather than feel like you want to give a little less? Really? The question is, who are you messing with? Do you see? Who are you messing with? That's what Malachi says. Remember who you're messing with. Here's the curse of churchianity. One, the curse of churchianity is this, that you may not truly believe at all. If at the end of the day, you've never truly trusted in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, if He is not the Lord of your life, if He is not central in your life, then that's unbelief. Do you see? That's unbelief. At the end of the day, that's unbelief. You haven't recognized God, right? And because it is unbelief, there's no salvation in it. There's no true life in it. And if God exists for you, that's not the God of the Bible. You've developed some other kind of God, and that's unbelief. Maybe you never truly believed in the first place. That's the curse of churchianity. And that's kind of sad, because you can go through your whole life with a false sense of security that you're a Christian, but all you've had was church. You never had Christ of the church. Do you see? But you say, wait a minute, okay, now Pastor Paul, you're talking about somebody else, because, you know, I'm a Christian. I trusted in Jesus as my Lord and Savior. Remember those tears you talked about? I shed those tears. I didn't only cry tears. I had snot and everything. I was just really broken before God. You know, I had that experience. Good. And I'm not telling you to doubt your faith. What I'm saying is, you're not immune to churchianity either. That it can have its influence on you. That the beauty of this world, the comfort of this life, can be all that church is really about for you. And if you opt for anything of the church without pursuing and seeking after and worshiping the Christ of the church, then you are selling out on Christ for churchianity. Even Christians can do that. Do you know who he's talking to here in Malachi? Pretty heavy message, I know, but a rebuke we need to hear. Do you know who he's talking to? Pastor Paul, that guy must be talking to people that are just cultural Christians, right? Right. They're the first kind of people, right? They just come in and they go out, and that's how it is, right? Pastor Paul, no. You know who he's talking to? He's talking to pastors. He's talking to pastors. He's talking to priests, it says here. The priests are offering God leftovers. Can you imagine offering God leftovers? Brothers and sisters, learn from my mistakes, okay? When I proposed to my wife, right? Because you do that in America, right? And so I proposed to my wife. I woke her up on my birthday, and it's because I was going to give myself the best gift in the world, right? So I was going to propose to her that day. Woke her up like 4 o'clock in the morning, right? And ladies, you got to wake up an hour before that. So I didn't realize that. I didn't let her sleep at all, basically. And then I took her. If I think about it now, this is a mess because, you know, she was all cool about it, but I took her to Sequoia, right? All the way up this mountain to a place called Moro Rock, not realizing, not being so, that she has a tendency toward car sickness, right? But by God's grace, I don't think she had car sickness that day. Anyway, I took her up to the, well, I can tell you that story later. But anyway, I packed lunch for that day. You know what I packed? No, I did worse than that. That would have been bad, but I did worse. I packed leftover jjigae, leftovers like casserole from the night before. I thought, oh, this is so good. I'm gonna share it with my lady, and I proposed to her. Can you believe that? Wow. So learn from my mistake. Never do that. Okay. Never, never, ever offer your date leftovers. All right? Whether you're a lady or a man, don't do that. Okay? What's this from? About 2 days ago. No, you don't do that. Okay, you don't do that. That's what it says here. He says, look, you offer me the lame, you offer me the blind, offer it to your governor and see if he'll accept it. And you're coming to me with that? And he's talking to priests. He's talking to pastors. Has God become so small in our eyes that we can deal with him so flippantly? And he can sneak up on the best of us. I remember one professor, Pastor Tony and I, we had the same professor. And it was only after that he went to seminary that he discovered Jesus at all. He thought he was a Christian, and then he went to seminary and really understood what it was. He was blasted by the glory of God's grace and truly became a Christian only in seminary. Isn't that good? A lot of people lose their faith, apparently, in seminary. They get all blessed and they're moved. I'm going to become a pastor. So they go to seminary and they realize, ooh, I have to study. And all of a sudden, doesn't look that rosy anymore. But for other people like this professor of mine, it was in seminary he realized how much God really loved him. So this message regarding avoiding churchianity is for pastors too. We all need to hear it. We have to make sure that our hearts don't get hardened, because God deserves and desires our heart worship. Worship that we give from the very core of our being, not surface level worship. Worship that says, I offer these things to you, not because I'm giving 10% or 20% or 30%, but because everything belongs to you anyway. That's the kind of worship God deserves and desires. Can I get an amen? Yeah. That's what the Bible says. In order to make that happen, in the book of Malachi, we're told that God is going to send his messenger, Elijah. Say that, everybody. Elijah. Elijah is the one that's going to be sent before the great day of God to turn the hearts of people toward God, the fathers and the sons toward God. Matthew chapter 17 tells us, these disciples come to Jesus and they say, Jesus, why does it say, if you're the Messiah, why does the Bible say in Malachi that Elijah has to come first? Jesus says, no, well, listen, guys, Elijah does come first. And actually, he did come, but the leaders missed him and they got him killed. And then they realized he was talking about John the Baptist. You know who that is, everybody, right? So John the Baptist came in the spirit of Elijah, and you know what he proclaimed? He looked at Jesus and said, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. He pointed to Jesus. He paved the way and pointed to Jesus. That was his role. He was to point beyond him. He was to decrease and Jesus was to increase. And when Jesus comes, what does he say? He says the same thing that Malachi said. Offer God your heart. Offer him your heart. Don't come to God with some surface level worship. Don't come to God with some kind of intellectualism, with these kinds of questions, pretend questions to come and attack me with. No, give God your hearts. When the Pharisees came at him with a question of this money, and they said, should we pay taxes to Caesar or not? You know what Jesus said? It was brilliant. Give to Caesar what bears Caesar's image, namely money, and give to God what bears God's image. Namely, everyone, what bears God's image? What should the leaders have known? We do. Offer to God your heart. Don't just come with questions to trap me. Listen to the words I say and offer to God your heart. Jesus keeps on reaching out to the very people that would kill him. Give God your hearts. And for this, what do they do? They nailed Jesus to the cross, breaking his heart in the process. Give God your heart. But you say, Pastor Paul, the things that you said today, wow, they apply to me. I find it hard to offer God my heart. When I come to worship, I think about the video game that I'm going to be playing back at home. When I come to worship, I worry about how other people are worshiping, what they're going to think of me, what that pretty girl is going to think of me if I sing too loud. She's going to hear my voice. I'm never going to get a chance. That's none of you, huh? I see absolutely no vibes here. Okay. Ladies, work a little harder, okay? I don't know. Okay. Anyway. We come with all kinds of distractions, and we kind of come with all kinds of imperfect worship. We come with all kinds of churchianity, and we're tempted to despair, right? We're tempted to give up. But what does Jesus do? It's like God says, all right, I'm tired of this. Y'all are not going to do it, so I'll do it for you. Look at what it says in Ezekiel chapter 36. Read this with me, everybody. Ready? Everybody? Including everybody? All right, here we go. Read this with me. 1, 2, 3. I will give you a new heart and a new spirit I will put within you. And I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you. Okay? What's the difference between a heart of stone and a heart of flesh? A heart of stone is dead. D-E-D, dead. Okay? You can knock on it, do whatever you want, it's dead. Heart of flesh is beating. It's alive. And God places in you the heart of flesh that he wants in worship. And he does that by his Holy Spirit. Jesus said to the woman at the well, he says this about worship. Read with me. The time is coming and now is when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. I capitalize the spirit because I think Jesus has Ezekiel 36 in mind. He says, I am going to give you the spirit, and in the gospel truth, it's like double, triple layer meaning here, you will worship with the very core of your being. You will worship God with the worship that he has always desired and always deserved. That's deep worship, not shallow worship, heart worship. And I am going to bring this about. He says, the time is coming and now is. What time was it? It was time for Jesus to be crucified on the cross, to die, to be buried, to be raised again, and to ascend into heaven. And Jesus said, when I ascend into heaven, what will he do? I'll send the Holy Spirit. And in Acts chapter 2, the Holy Spirit comes, invades the hearts of human beings just like you and me. And he's been doing that for 2,000 years. Can I get an amen? And that's why you, if you have come to faith, that's why you are sitting here in this room today. If you have accepted Christianity, it's because the Holy Spirit has invaded your heart. If you don't have the Holy Spirit, you are still in churchianity. If there has not been a fundamental shift in your loyalty, if you are still living for yourself, if church is still all about you and not about Jesus, if your pleasure is not oriented to him, then you are still in churchianity, not in Christianity. You know what? Jesus says this, if anybody loves father or mother more than me, he is not worthy of me. That's what Jesus said. He calls for absolute loyalty. Do you know what sin is? Sin is to prefer anything other than God. Prefer anything to God is to love anything more than you love God. You love your parents more than you love God? That's not Christianity, that's churchianity. Do you love your job more than you love God? Then that's churchianity, it's not Christianity. You see? True Christianity loves God above everything. God is your supreme, greatest treasure and highest pleasure. That's true Christianity, and anything less than that is not, according to the scriptures. Not me. Don't get mad at me. That's what the Bible says. Pastor Paul, you set the bar pretty high. No, I don't. Listen, what is Christianity? What is a Christian? He's a person. She's a person that recognizes, listen, that the God of the universe, we just talked about that, right? Listen, everyone, this is most important than anything you'll hear from school, okay? Anything you'll hear out there. Most important, this is the core of the scriptures. Look, if you're a Christian, you say you believe in a God who created the whole world. You believe in a God who put on flesh and bone. You believe in a God who died on the cross and let every single drop of blood and water pour out on your behalf, Not for somebody else, but for you. And if you're a Christian, you're saying that this God has come to invade your life and have a relationship with you. That's what it means to be a Christian, right? That's the bare bones meaning of a Christian. You have that relationship with God. If you are dealing with that kind of a Jesus, how can he but change your life? How can he but be central? How can he but talk into, speak into, be involved in, and transform the way you study, the way you work, the way you do life, the way you have family, the way you do anything? How? Right? Doesn't that just make sense? It's logical. It is supremely logical to say that anything less than having God as first priority, the core around which you structure all of your life, anything less than that is not true faith. It's not true worship. Boy, that's uncomfortable, right? It can be uncomfortable. But I'm not saying that you do this perfectly. I'm saying fundamentally, is he your Lord? And do you fight to see him as Lord of your daily habits, of your worship time, of your dealing with your mom and dad, your friends and brothers and sisters? If you do, if there's a fight there, if there's a fight, that's a good indication of life. Do you see what I'm saying? I think it's time for me to share that one story again regarding the corpse in a corpse in med school, right? Right? The corpse in med school. You can dissect the corpse doesn't do anything, right? I cut my story short completely. But the story goes something like this. A guy goes in, he's a tough guy, he doesn't care about what, he doesn't mind that there are these cadavers, these dead bodies there. But he has to look at the hand, right? He has to dissect the hand. So what does he do? All right, heads up, this is a gross story for everybody, right? Okay, everybody? So he has to take the fingers, because that guy died, maybe he was greedy, trying to hold on to something, but he died like this. And so the medical student had to peel back the fingers to get into the inside, right? And as he was doing that, what happened was the fingernails came off, right? And that's exactly what he did. And he said, get me out of here. Everybody, guess what the corpse did? Got up. No, I'm just kidding. No, it didn't. It lay there, didn't do diddly squat because it was dead. D-E-D, dead. All right? I know. But you remember that, hopefully. But if you are fighting to keep Jesus central in your life, at least it indicates to me you are alive. Hear me? Okay? It's a good indication of life. So I want to challenge you today then. How do you live the Christian life? The life that says God has come to invade your life. Don't let your heart be hardened. Don't let your heart be hardened. Only a life of complete devotion, absolute devotion, worship to God that is better than your very best makes sense in the light of who God is and what he has done in his son. Clear, right? I've said that I don't know how many times now. Absolute, complete devotion, God as first priority in all of your life. Not comfort Christianity, not cultural acceptance, not man-centered worship, but God-centered, Christ-exalting worship. That's what we are about. And everything less than that is just an invention of your brain, and it'll die with you. And I don't want you to die. At the end of the day, I'm afraid, as we go to our new place of worship, it's going to be bigger than this. It's going to be about twice as big as the complex we have here, a little more than that. Everything is going to be new. Apparently, it's not going to be waterproof. It started to rain like crazy. Was that crazy rain or a lot or what, everybody? I heard that it's called Lucifer, right? It flooded like everywhere. I tried to avoid the freeway because it was stopped. I went on the local street and there was a river down there, right? You should have got out your boogie board or something, right? Hurricane Harbor, indeed. All right. What I'm trying to say is that when we go to the new place, and you've got all those new things around you, and already I'm talking about different kinds of programs for the children and all of that, you're going to be tempted to make that what Christianity is, and it's not. Christianity is not shiny buildings and new speakers. Christianity is not just a bunch of programs that we set up for kids to go through and learn a little bit of morality and become upstanding citizens. Christianity is nothing less than Christ, Christ, Christ. Can I get an amen? Let's not fall short of that. Let's not fall short of that. Children, let me talk to you. All right? Jonathan, Jeremiah, Kairi, Micah, Bless, Given, and I got your names right this time. Okay, Joey, how can you avoid having your heart hardened and doing church as churchianity? Don't think that this is your mom and dad's religion, okay? Don't be satisfied with coming to church because your mom and dad drag you. Your mom and dad can't go to heaven for you. Your mom and dad can't have a relationship with Jesus instead of you. You have to receive him. You have to trust him. Jesus must be real to you. Jesus must be everything to you. Follow your parents' example, but follow it all the way. Trust in Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Structure your life around him. And when your mom and dad want to do something that's going to compromise their faith, you be the one to encourage them to hang in there and forsake churchianity and opt for Christianity. You be that one. You take ownership. You're not too young. I know people who have loved the Lord from before they can even think. I remember Ruthie. Ruthie, one time, she did something, and one of our kids said to her, "Ruthie, that's not Christian." And you know, this is one of my best memories of her responses. She said, "Daddy, Daddy, Albert said I'm not a Christian," and she started crying. I love that. It should mean that much to you. And Albert was like, "But that's not what I meant. That's not what I said." Poor guy. This little kid's just gonna break it all over him. But I want to tell you, hey, Jesus must be real to you. And this is my plea with you, that you will not opt for a churchianity by following your mom and dad, letting Jesus be all about them. Let it be about their religion and not yours. No. Let it be about your relationship with Jesus. Married couples, don't become intoxicated with doing church respectably, okay? Church is something that good, settled down people do. I love you, and I don't want you to settle for this. A lot of guys, you know what they do? They become Christians in junior high school, because they don't know any better, apparently, right? They become rocked with Jesus, and their life changes a little bit, and then when they graduate from high school, they graduate from Jesus. They go out for the party life. They think that they can live that life, whatever that life is, for a while. And then they get married. And they think they should settle down. They should cool it a little bit. And you're not responsible only for yourself anymore. You got your wife and kids now. You got to behave a little bit. You got to stop. You got to forget about that motorcycle, and you got to, you know, to stop climbing those high trees and stuff like that. Don't do anything stupid anymore. And one of the ways to not do anything stupid anymore is to go to church, get a routine, and let your kids grow up. No, that's churchianity, folks. That's not Christianity. Knowing Jesus entails that, your children growing up loving the Lord, absolutely. But settle for Jesus. Strive after him. The way that your children are going to grow up knowing him is as they watch you know Jesus, as they see you see Jesus as meaning more than everything. And when you do that, everything else that you do, all the work that you work so hard at, will really have lasting significance. Don't let church be something that you do on the side. Jesus will never, never accept that kind of worship. Have him be the core and central, be everything to you, and everything else falls into place. That's my heart's prayer for you. And I want to challenge, like, those people, those of you who have been in Jesus for a long time, don't settle. Don't settle for the Jesus that you've known. Remember, I told you these warnings are to pastors. Pastors. And I want to tell you right now, I feel in my sane moment, I feel like I'm just scratching the surface as to how much Jesus has loved me. And it's awesome. But I know I've got so much more to go and to grow. And the Bible indicates that I'll have an eternity to do it. And you think you've experienced all there is to Christianity? Then you're not full of Jesus, you're full of yourself. You need to repent of that. And tear back the layers. And don't let your heart be hardened. And look to Jesus as your greatest treasure and highest pleasure again and again and again. Don't let the gospel, the good news, loved ones, that God has loved you this much in Jesus, ever become old to you. Stand in awe of it. Kneel in awe of it every single day of your life. And when you feel your heart getting hardened, spend some time pursuing Him. Pursue Him in His Word. Pursue Him in prayer. Take some time out and look to Him. Do you feel dry spiritually? Then take some time out. Exercise the Christian F word. What is that? Fasting. Fasting, because that's very offensive to many Christians, right? But take some time out and say, I love you, God, more than this, more than these video games. I will set that aside, more than food even. I'll set that aside because you mean more to me. You're more satisfying to me than food. And let me seek your face. You're facing transition. You're going to a new school. You're getting a new job. Spend some time with the Lord to see how best you can honor Him and love Him in the process. Pursue Him. Pursue Him. Pursue Him. Give Him deep heart worship. This is the worship God deserves and desires, and never stop.